Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship on this beautiful morning. A special welcome to our guests and visitors and also those worshiping online with us across the United States and Canada. Please let us know where you're worshiping from this morning. Note the announcements in the bulletin, the flowers placed by John and Jean Gerfen in celebration of their 57th wedding anniversary. We celebrate with them. In the back of the bulletin on page 19 are some highlights that need to be made. First of all, our sympathy to Shirley and Paul. They had a death in the family. They'll be going later this week to Ohio, but there will be choir rehearsal this week on Wednesday. Note also this morning there is a potluck after this worship. All are invited. There's always more than enough to feed everyone. Thank you to all who provided for Peter's for the Yuma Food Pantry this day. Also note that Ash Wednesday is coming very soon. On Valentine's Day, worship is at 6 p.m. Please mark your calendars. New member class begins next Sunday after this service. And also note one of the two big events in February is coming up, and that being the Dinner Theater. The details are there. That is the 15th, 16th, and 17th. The tickets are available, good food, good entertainment. The other thing that is big during February is the yard sale. They have so much fun doing that. They get to meet people and make friendships. So if you're looking for friends and fun, that's a great place to go and do that. They have a meeting this Thursday, the February 8th at 1 p.m. Come and join in. Also, we have a number of people as trained caregivers called Stephen Ministers. They're great at listening. And if you're going through crisis or you know someone who is, please give a call. We would like to be able to be there with them for them. As we worship this day, we celebrate our Lord's Supper. Our Lord's Supper is open to all baptized believers who trust in Jesus as Savior and who seek to learn to live with Him as Lord of all areas of life. At this time, it is served around the communion rail. Some kneel, some stand. You receive in your hands the wafer of bread, which is the body of Christ, and you have a choice between individually filled cups, the darker liquid being wine, the lighter liquid, a fruit juice, the blood of Christ. We do ask that you would take one of these colorful communion slips from the pew rack and fully fill out the front side, put your prayer requests at the bottom, and they're given to the prayer ministry later this afternoon. There are other options on the reverse side that you might wish to consider, and simply place that in the offering plate as it comes by. I invite you to stand. We begin our worship on page 3 in the folded bulletin as we affirm together that God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
God is good.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God full of compassion and mercy, abounding in steadfast love.
Amen.
We take time to confess our sins before God and one another. Guiding God, we have failed to follow you as we ought. We have not reached out to our neighbors with the selfless and sacrificial love you modeled for us. We have caused harm to others and your creation by our inactions and our unwillingness to act. Forgive us our sins and lead us back onto the path you have trod for the sake of others. In Christ, God meets us where we are and as we are, and for his sake, God makes us whole and holy. Go forth to follow Jesus in the assurance that your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Our gathering hymn number 886.
Thank you.
continue our worship on page 5 in the folded bulletin. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Together we pray, God of justice, John the Baptist spoke truth to power, though it cost him his life. Give us courage to stand up to the corrupt powers of our own age on behalf of the oppressed, trusting in the promise of your presence in all that we do and say. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Please generously share God's peace with all around.
Today we will read the 122nd Psalm responsively. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. Jerusalem, built as a city that is bound firmly together. To it the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, as was decreed for Israel, to give thanks to the name of the Lord. For there the thrones for judgment were set up, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May they prosper who love you. Peace be within your walls and security within your towers. For the sake of my relatives and friends, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, we'll seek your good.
Please stand for the singing of the gospel acclamation and the reading of the Holy Gospel. Gospel for this morning from the Gospel according to St. Mark, the 6th chapter. Jesus left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James, Joseph, Judas and Simon, and are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid hands on a few of sick people and cured them. He was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went out among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. And if any place will not welcome you, and if they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. King Herod heard of it, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, "John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him." But others said, "It is Elijah." And others said, "It is a prophet like one of the prophets of old." But when Herod heard of it, he said, "John, whom I beheaded, has been raised." For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, "It is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife." And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him. But she could not, for Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests, and the king said to the girl, "Ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it." And he swore to her, "Whatever you ask me, I will give you in half of my kingdom." She went out and said to her mother, "What should I ask for?" She replied, "The head of John the Baptizer." Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, "I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter." The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and his guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went out and beheaded him in prison and brought his head on a platter and gave it to the girl. Then the girl gave it to her mother. And his disciples heard about it. They came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. This is the gospel of our Lord. Please be seated. A few months before his 75th birthday, George began planning his party. And he called his 45-year-old daughter and asked for her help. She had an idea. She said, "Why don't you invite all of your old high school buddies? That could be a lot of fun." And he said, "I'd like to invite all of my high school buddies to the party, but I don't want to get arrested." His daughter laughed. She said, "Well, why would you be arrested for bringing your high school buddies to your birthday party?" George replied, "Don't you know, dear, grave robbing is a crime." Today's text is probably one of the best known birthday party stories ever told. Herod had a birthday party that was beyond anything that you could ever imagine. But to better understand this gospel lesson for this morning, we need to know a little bit more about Herod, because the Herod in the text is Herod Antipas. He was the son of Herod the Great. Herod the Great was the ruthless king who was in power when Jesus was born, the very one who had the children of Bethlehem, the holy innocents, murdered because he feared that his power was going to be compromised. But his son, Herod Antipas, sadly followed in his father's footsteps, and at an early age, he tried to get himself named king, and so he was banished to Palestine, where he built his capital city known as Tiberias, which was actually built on an ancient Jewish burial ground, thereby showing his contempt for Jewish religious practices. So later on a visit to Rome, Herod met Herodias, his brother Philip's wife. And he murdered Philip, divorced his own wife, and married Herodias before returning to Palestine with her and her daughter Salome. And it was there that John the Baptist encountered them and issued a judgment against them because of what they had done. And it was because of this public announcement, this public admonishment of their marriage, that Herodias hated John, and she wanted him killed. And yet Herod took him into, I guess, what we could describe as protective custody. And it's a historic record. Even the Jewish scholar alive at the time, Josephus, writes of Herod's interest in John the Baptist. So we're told that Herod actually enjoys listening to John, listening to this prophet, even if he doesn't understand what he's talking about. But Herodias hates John the Baptist because of his condemnation of her new marriage. So at Herod's birthday party, in front of all of his friends and leaders of his day, his stepdaughter, Salome, dances. Despite the custom that respectable women don't provide this kind of local gentlemen's club entertainment at these sorts of gatherings. That, as it turned out, it probably would have been a whole lot better had Herod given all of his buddies a bunch of shekels to tip the dancers and visited the local gentleman's establishment. But Herodias, the wife of Herod and the mother of Salome, is not even present there where the dancing occurs. And Herod is so pleased with Salome's dancing that he promises to give her anything that she wishes, even half of his kingdom. And Salome goes and talks it over with her mother, and Herodias tells her to ask for the head of John the Baptist on a platter. So Herod is left with quite a moral dilemma. He made a promise, but now there are some unintended consequences. So the guards are ordered, then the guards went and did as they were ordered and returned with the head of John the Baptist on a platter. And you can imagine everybody in the room saw all of this and probably needed a powerful aid to go to sleep after that. So what do you suppose happened at the palace the next morning when Herod woke up with a hangover about the size of the Roman Empire and a public relations problem about twice as big? You can imagine the political spinning that went along with that account, right? It's not what it seems. It's not my fault. I'm not to blame. Probably sounded a lot like our evening news. So John the Baptist tells the truth about Herod and Herodias, and this text tells us the consequences of telling the truth. So even while we affirm with Jesus that the truth will make you free, we also must recognize that it might get you arrested and killed, or that your faith may lead to many other unintended consequences. Because if you really live for Jesus, you will be unwelcomed by some. Jesus told his own disciples to expect rejection. Back in 2002, Ron Brown was a University of Nebraska assistant football coach. The Daily Nebraskan reported that he was denied the head coaching job at Stanford University because of his religious beliefs. Alan Glenn, Stanford's assistant athletic director, said to the student newspaper that Ron Brown's religion was definitely something that had to be considered because we're a very diverse community with very diverse alumni. Ron Brown said, "They had no problem telling me that it was because of my Christian beliefs, but Stanford's rejection will not silence my belief. You cannot compromise truth, whatever the job." And yet, remarkably, a number of newspapers across the country applauded Stanford University for its decision. It seems that in our culture, tolerance extends to everyone but Christians. And yet, as Christians, we need to realize that our faith must affect our lives. Oprah Winfrey was once interviewing people on her program who were having affairs with married people. Now, it seemed like a great subject for that bottom fishing type of TV in our time. And one woman was there who had a long-standing affair with a married man, and she was saying how happy she was. But then someone raised the question of morality. And the woman protested. She said, "Wait a minute. I'm a Christian, but my personal life and my religion don't have anything to do with one another. God wants me to be happy. And if I'm happy with this man, then God doesn't mind." Is God only happy in making us happy? Is God like some kind of eternal babysitter letting us constantly have our own way? Can we believe in God and live like the devil? Or can we sow wild oats and then show up once a week in worship and pray for crop failure? Well, see, that's not the picture that we get of God that we get from John the Baptist. John reminds us that following Jesus will not always be easy. John reminds us that there are tough decisions, tough choices to make every day that might go against the flow of the world's ways. And they're ours to make. There's a story about a young police officer who was taking his final exam for the police academy, and he was given the following problem situation to solve. You are on patrol in the outer city when an explosion occurs in the gas main in a nearby street. On investigation, you find a large hole has been blown into the street, and there is an overturned van nearby. Inside the van, there is a strong smell of alcohol. Both occupants, a man and a woman, are injured. You recognize the woman as the wife of the chief of police who was out of town at that time. A passing motorist stops you to offer assistance, and you realize that he's the man who is wanted for armed robbery. Suddenly, a man runs out of a nearby house shouting that his wife was expecting a baby, or is expecting a baby, and that the shock of the explosion has made birth imminent. Another man is crying for help, having been blown into the adjacent canal by an explosion, and he cannot swim. And then it read, "Describe in a few words what actions you would take." The young man thought for a moment, picked up his pencil and wrote, "I would take off my uniform and mingle with the crowd." But isn't that what happens with us sometimes? Just as that wouldn't do for the policeman, so as we followers of Jesus cannot duck our responsibilities either. We can't just blend in with the crowd, because we're often called to swim against the tide of public opinion as we walk with Jesus to bring new life and hope to every person. You might recall in the early 2000s, when the U.S. was part of a coalition to invade Iraq and depose Saddam Hussein, you might remember that not everyone was in favor of that war. There were some protests covered by the media. They were interviewed one angry young man and asked him why he was opposed to the war, and he said these words, "Nothing is worth dying for." Do you believe that? No. Charles Colson told a story of a group of World War II American prisoners of war who were made to do hard labor in a Japanese prisoner of war camp. And each had a shovel, and each dug all day, and they were required to turn in the shovels each evening. And one evening, 20 prisoners lined up by the guard, and their shovels were counted, and the guard counted only 19 shovels. And he turned in rage toward the POWs and demanded to know which prisoner had kept his shovel. And no one responded. The guard drew his pistol and said that he would shoot 5 American prisoners if the guilty prisoner didn't confess. After a moment of tense silence, a 19-year-old prisoner stepped forward with his head bowed. The guard pointed his gun at the prisoner's head and fired. As the young man's body fell to the ground, the guard warned the others that they must always return their shovels. And then the guard recounted the shovels and found that all 20 were accounted for. He had simply miscounted earlier. The young man died for his friends. Would you like to have a friend like that? You do. His name is Jesus, the Son of God, the crucified and risen Savior of the world. And this Jesus calls us to follow him every day of our lives, knowing that it will not be easy, knowing that it will require us to take stands against the ways of the world, knowing that there will be times when sacrifice is required. And yet, as people who come to worship God this day, we are constantly called, as our mission statement says, to be following Jesus, to bring new life and hope to every person. Please stand for prayer. Holy Lord God, when we find ourselves challenged with those choices, help us to have you so strong in our heart and life that we honor you with the choice we make. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn of the day, number 787. During the last verse of that hymn, the installation, the council members will come forward for installation.
Thank you.
In holy baptism, our Lord Jesus Christ liberated you from sin and death and made you members of his church. Through word and sacrament, you have been nurtured in faith. I ask you, together with all who are here gathered, to confess the faith of the church, the faith in which we are baptized, using the words of the Apostles' Creed on page 11. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. St. Paul writes, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of serving, but the same Lord is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives to everyone ability for a particular service. The Spirit's presence is shown in some way in each person for the good of all. You have been elected to positions of leadership and trust in this congregation. You are to see that the words and deeds of this household of faith reflect him in whose name we gather. You are to work together with other members to see that the worship and work of Christ are done in this congregation and that God's will is done in this community and in the whole world. You are to be diligent in your specific area of serving, that the one Lord who empowers you is glorified. You are to be examples of faith active in love to help maintain the life and harmony of this congregation. On behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you as council members, are you ready to accept and faithfully carry out the duties of the offices to which you have been elected? If so, answer yes by the help of God. People of God, I ask you, will you support these, your elected leaders, and will you share in the mutual ministry that Christ has given to all the baptized? If so, answer yes, by the help of God.
Yes.
I now declare you installed as officers and council members of this congregation. God bless you with his Holy Spirit, that you may prove faithful servants of Christ. Amen. Please return to your seats. We continue with the prayers of the church at the last verse of the last hymn of the service. Our council will come to the back so that they might greet you as you come out. Trusting in the good news of Jesus Christ, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of courage, guide us to stand firm in our convictions, even in the face of opposition. May we honor those who speak truth to power, including activists, whistleblowers, and children who challenge injustice with innocence and determination. God, draw near. Creator of integrity, inspire us to live lives of honesty and principle. May we value the work of those who strive to uphold moral standards, reflecting your desire for righteousness and truth. God, draw near. Together we pray. We pray for each of our mission congregations, local partners, and care ministries. We also pray for the congregation's vision and call process. May we continue to work toward our mission and uphold our values while we support the call committee in moving toward a pastoral transition. We also pray for that pastor whom God calls to Glory to Christo to work with us to move this congregation forward. Enlarge our hearts toward people far from God while we walk with Jesus to bring new life and hope to every person. Guide our leaders, lawmakers, and those who wield power that they may do so with wisdom and a deep sense of responsibility. God, draw near. Healing God, we pray for those who are in need of courage and strength, especially those we remember in our hearts. May they find comfort in your love, and many mentors, friends, and even inspiring stories be instruments of your grace and encouragement. God, draw near. Give wisdom, we pray, for those who navigate complex ethical dilemmas, including judges, medical professionals, and all who face difficult decisions. God, draw near. We remember the saints who have gone before us, those who have lived their lives of courage and integrity. May we be inspired by their example, honoring the legacy of saints, prophets, and all who have embraced your call with fortitude and faithfulness. God, draw near. We lift all these prayers and more to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, our ushers will come forward to receive our morning's offerings to the Lord's work. For those worshiping online, there should be a link to follow, or you can call the church office. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth. In mercy for our fallen world, you gave your only Son, that all those who believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. We give thanks to you for the salvation you have prepared for us through Jesus Christ. Send now your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may receive our Lord with a living faith as he comes to us in his Holy Supper. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this also for the remembrance of me. We pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our communion assistants will come forward. stand. We continue our worship on page 17. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you safe in his grace until everlasting life. Amen. Together we pray, God of steadfast love, at this table you gather your people into one body for the sake of the world. Send us in the power of your Spirit, that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our sending hymn number 545. I want to thank all who have been worshiping online and those in person. You're all invited next door if you're here. There's plenty of food for you. Almighty God has created you and has a purpose for your life every day. Lord, help us remember, if you are not dead, live your lives in Christ, rooted and built up in him, and abound in thanksgiving. And the blessing of the Holy Trinity, one God, be upon you and may remain with you forever. Go in peace. Christ is sending you.